Let's discuss axio-appendicular muscles, and we broached the subject when we were talking about muscles of the thorax, specifically the anterior muscles. Now, these muscles we're discussing here because they're going to play a bigger role in terms of the shoulder joint. Some of these muscles attach directly to the scapula and will play a role in terms of movement of the scapula, but more of them are going to play a role in terms of the movement of the glenohumeral joint. So moving the pectoral girdle in addition to the glenohumeral. And when we're talking anteriorly, the main muscles that we're talking about are your pectoralis muscles. And we've probably all heard of these. And when we think of the pectoralis muscles, we're mainly thinking about the pectoralis major. And deep to the pectoralis major is the pec minor. Now on this side, you're going to have your serratus anterior muscles. And this is a really unique muscle in terms of its innervation. So let's start with pectoralis major. This is going to have two different heads associated with it. You're going to have a clavicular head and a sternocostal head, so attached to the sternum and the costal cartilages. Both heads, when they're contracting, are going to be very important in terms of adduction, or bringing the shoulder joint back to anatomical position, as well as medial rotation of the shoulder. So this, you have to have both muscles, or both heads contracting. But they can contract individually, and they'll actually be antagonists to one another. So the clavicular head's going to flex, whereas the sternocostal head can extend. So this is very unique. Not all muscles can actually do opposite motions, but these, since there are two different heads, can. So you can see here, you have the nipple in this region, you have your deltoid right here, and this is your pec major. Now, like I said, pectoralis minor is going to be deep to major, so you can see your major has been reflected here, and the much smaller pectoralis minor here. So this one doesn't actually play a role in terms of the glenohumeral joint. It's going to play a very important role in terms of stabilizing the scapula, specifically in movements allowing for the higher range of motion of the glenohumeral and keeping that scapula where it needs to be. And this particular muscle has an attachment to that coracoid process, you remember, on the anterior side of the scapula. The serratus anterior, and this is one of my favorite muscles, I think it's a very uniquely shaped, you can see it's this sawtooth appearance here. This is your serratus anterior. Now, this is a very unique muscle in the fact that the nerve, which you can't see in this image, but I kind of show you where it would be, is actually going to run superficial to the muscle, okay? So most nerves you're going to see on the deep side of the muscle. This is not true for the serratus anterior. It's going to be on the superficial side. So if you have direct blow to this side or some type of stabbing wound in this area, it can directly damage that long thoracic nerve and cause what we refer to as a winged scapula, or the scapula will kind of move posteriorly out of the way, okay? So if you think of protraction, kind of putting the scapula out like that, if you're doing a push-up, this is where the serratus anterior is really playing a big role. Okay, so those are the main anterior muscles. Let's move on the posterior side, and it's quite a bit more complex in this region. You have three main categories of region. You have superficial, and these are going to be the larger of the muscles, your trapezius and your latissimus dorsi. Your deep, we're not going to go into too much detail here. They don't play a big role in terms of the actions, but these muscles are referred to as the rhomboids. You have a rhomboid major and a rhomboid minor, and your levator scapulae. And then muscles associated with the intrinsic shoulder, so playing an important role in terms of not only the actions of the shoulder joint, but also the stability of the shoulder joint. And we all have heard of the deltoid. That's the muscle, that kind of cap on top of your shoulder. And then your rotator cuff muscles, which are forming kind of a very important protection on either side of the shoulder joint. So let's start with the superficial muscles. Now, I know we've talked about trapezius before, but a real quick review. It's going to be this trapezoid-shaped muscle here. It's not going to play a role directly in terms of the shoulder joint. It's really playing a role in terms of the scapula. So similar to the pectoralis minor in terms of stabilization. As you move inferiorly, you have this bigger fan-shaped muscle, or your latissimus dorsi. This does actually attach to the humerus, so crossing the glenohumeral joint, and can play a role in terms of extension, adduction, and medial rotation. So extension, adduction, and medial rotation. A lot of actions that come into play when you're swimming. So oftentimes you hear this muscle referred to as the swimmer's muscle. So anytime you look at a swimmer, they'll have very developed latissimus dorsi muscles. The deltoid muscle is going to be that cap that you can see right here on the top. A very thick, very robust muscle. It's an area of intramuscular injection, so if you think of where you get your shots, oftentimes it's in the deltoid. The main role of the deltoid muscle is abduction. It is going to do the majority of abduction of the shoulder joint. So think about moving your arm this way. But different areas of the deltoid, so different muscle fibers of the deltoid, can also play a role in terms of flexion and extension of the shoulder joint. It's going to be innervated by one of the terminal branches of the brachial plexus, your axillary nerve. Then all the rest, the rotator cuff muscles. We talked quite a bit about the rotator cuff muscles when we discussed the specifics of the glenohumeral joint, but let's talk a little bit more about the actions that can occur at these joints. So if you're talking about all the posterior muscles, here you have your supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor. So let's look at these here. Supraspinatus is above the scapular spine. Infraspinatus is below. That makes sense, the names make sense. And then underneath here, you have the teres minor. These are all going to attach on that greater tubercle of the humerus. That's why the greater tubercle is larger than the lesser tubercle. Supraspinatus is going to initiate, and I should have put this in here, it's going to initiate abduction. So allowing for the movement of abduction to start, and then the deltoid muscle will take over. Whereas infraspinatus and teres minor are going to play a role in terms of lateral rotation of the shoulder joint. If you were to flip on the other side, now we're looking at an anterior view, you have your subscapularis muscle, which is quite a large muscle. It's pretty much taking up the whole space right here. This is going to attach on the lesser tubercle of the humerus. It's the only muscle that attaches here. That's why the lesser tubercle is going to be smaller. And as opposed to the infraspinatus and the teres minor, subscapularis is going to be a medial rotator of the shoulder. So, you've heard of rotator cuff muscles probably before. This is an area that is often damaged. Specifically, or more commonly, you're going to have your supraspinatus tendon being damaged. So let's talk about why that would be. So let's find supraspinatus here. You're going to see it located here. The tendon's going to be attaching to the greater tubercle. And if you think about, you have some bones right here, specifically your acromion process. You have your coracoid process here. You have a very strong ligament right here. And in actions of circumduction, it's going to get pinched often. So if you are an individual that circumducts your arm quite a bit, so if you think of a baseball pitcher, you're using that area quite a bit, there's going to be friction, and that can lead to damage or a tear in terms of the supraspinatus tendon. So that's why you're going to have this being the most commonly injured of the specific tendons of the shoulder, of the rotator cuff. If you have damage here, this can cause quite a bit of instability because this is really the main force in terms of protecting your glenohumeral joint. And recall, and we've discussed this in terms of the joints, it's forming this kind of ring around, but then you have this weak area inferiorly. So when you have that dislocation, it'll move inferiorly and then typically anteriorly.